Good evening. This lecture, Bezrat Hashem, will be Leilui Nishmat, Sofia Sonia Batsara, Leilui Nishmat Zev Ben Suraya, and Lerfuat Yitzchak Ben Dina, and Lerfuat Aliza Malka Batlea, and all the people that we read in the list here, Bezrat Hashem, everyone with his needs. Baruch Hashem, a year after the world became crazy, we are still standing here today and we don't know what's next, what's going to happen, where we're going to be in a month or two. Nobody knows. Some people in their business got wiped out. Some people lost their home. Some people died. Few of them I knew. Not all of them were old. 67. It's not so old. So, Baruch Hashem, HaKadosh Baruch Hu, in the last Rosh Hashanah, not this one, the one before, when he decided it's all going to start, nobody ever dreamed that that's going to be such a year, what we call 2020. Now, everybody fights about one thing. Should I get a vaccine? Should I not get a vaccine? Vaccine, vaccine, all day, all night. 90% of the questions that I get is about this. Half a day I get compliments from people. Half a day I get curses and complaints from people. Everyone according to his agenda. Those who are anti-vaccine, they go crazy when they hear someone speaks for it. And those who promote vaccine, they're very happy that they have someone to use his name to back their agenda. I found out that almost not even 1% of the people care really about the truth. It's all about the ego. Everyone care only about if I will be right or not. That's what it is. Which is very interesting, because I decided to talk today about some things that relates to the way that we behave. Why? Because I knew there's going to be a lot of people here that are already religious. They already keep Shabbat. They already go to shul. Women who already dress modest. People that follow the Torah. What do I have to talk about when I speak to people that believe in God? People that believe that the Torah is the book of God. What do I have to talk to them about? To prove to them that Torah is divine? Waste of time. To prove to them that God runs the show? Waste of time. This is what you talk to beginners. We have to talk about something that all religious people needs improvement in. Big improvement. What is it? The answer is behaving. The midot. You may say, that's what we came here tonight to hear? What is this, kindergarten? Don't you think I know how to behave as a religious man or as a religious woman? The answer is, not only you don't know how to behave, when you will hear some of the things that you do wrong, you will be shocked how terrible these things are in the eyes of Hashem. Sometimes, as bad as being Mechalel Shabbat, as bad as it is to be Mechalel Shabbat, it's written 12 times in the Torah that Mechalel Shabbat with his own hands cut his neshama, his soul, from the Jewish nation. And because of that, when everybody goes to heaven, those the people who kept Shabbat and were righteous, he unfortunately will see what he have done for his own neshama, chaval. A lot of people will be very upset when they leave this world, Mechalelei Shabbat. But that's not the topic here tonight. There's other things that makes Hashem very angry at the human being. Very angry. Let's go one by one. What are the two things that Hashem hates the most about the human being? The worst. That if a person has it, even if he's very religious, he's fanatic, he daven nets every morning.
Not
6 o'clock in the morning, he's in a shul, and he gives tons of tzedakah, and he learns a lot of Gemara. But he has these two things, is already putting him in a very bad condition. The first one is gaava, pride, ego. Everything must be my way. I only know everything and no one else knows anything. Everybody must agree with me. Anyone who will go against me will be finished. I will teach them a lesson. It's my way or the highway. That's gava. And the second thing is ungratefulness. Kfuye tova. People that you do a favor for them, not only they don't appreciate it, they deny it. I'll give you an example. Today I spoke to someone in Israel. I told him, enough wasting time on these conspiracy theories on YouTube. Enough. That's not what the Jews are supposed to do. Someone who's religious, enough with all these shtuyot. This scientist say this, this doctor say yes, this one say no. Enough with this. Focus on Torah and Yirat Shamayim. Leave the world for Hashem. Work on your soul. Then we started to talk about something he saw. And I say to him, the person that made that claim is somebody that I made Baal Tshuva 23 years ago. I know the person. This person has a very big imagination. He imagines things and he believes his imagination, and then he goes and makes all kinds of video about it, and he makes a lot of people go to the wrong direction. Maybe he means well, but he doesn't. This person, 23 years ago, I went to give a lecture in Manhattan. I went to visit my friend in Manhattan, and they told me that night he has about 40 Israeli guys playing cards over there, like casino, tables. So my friend told me, you came in a perfect timing. This was when I was on my way. So my friend told me, you came in a perfect timing. Why? Everybody is here. You will be able to see all our friends from the past. They're all here tonight. As soon as I heard that, I take my overhead projector. I didn't have a laptop yet. It was transparencies. I came up. I put it on the table, I set it up on the wall with a projector, and I was ready for them. Let's say how long until they move from the poker table to listen to my Divrei Torah. One guy lost his money, joined me in a couch. Another one. I started to give them a lecture. I didn't ask them, do you want a lecture or not? This is all 40 secular guys, all Mechalele Shabbat, all big shots in business. This guy has a modeling agency. This guy has few car dealers. This one has poker machines all over New York. Every one of them. This one owns Moishe's Moving. Big shots. People that have many, many millions of dollars. I started to talk. It became a 4 hours lecture. 4 hours. All the proofs. A real seminar. Complete seminar. That night, two guys became religious. That night already. After a few months, half of them became religious. It just took them longer. One guy became this, one guy make meals for Shabbat, one guy does in Great Neck hospitalities for people for Shabbat, this one give all kinds of... Everyone did something. One of the two people is this person that I'm talking about. That night, for the first time in his life, he saw the truth of the Torah. Then I saw that he's more serious than the other people. I invited him for my house in Monsi for Shabbat. He said, come to me for Shabbat, because he asked me a lot of questions after. He told me that his grandfather was a very righteous man. He was blind, but all day he spoke Divrei Torah. And I just woke him up. He never knew about the truth of the Torah. I realized this guy is already half in. I told him, would you come to my house for Shabbat? He said, well, will you invite me? I said, yes. So I gave him the address and he came for Shabbat. The entire Shabbat, I sat with him. After that, he told me, that's it. I'm leaving everything I do and I go to Israel to yeshiva. I don't know alphabet. He was 36 years old. I don't know alphabet. I'm giving the rights of all my work to my lawyer. I don't want to enjoy from it. I just realized my work is not kosher. I'm going to yeshiva. I said to him, don't run too fast. People that jump from 0 to 80 in one shot, they collapse later on. You gotta start progressing week by week. No. I wasted enough time. I gotta go to yeshiva. I say to him, before you go to the yeshiva, we have a seminar in 2 weeks. Let me take you to the seminar. After you see everything, then you'll decide. I took him to the seminar. He became even more religious. Because it's all the proofs, everything. Basically, he became very religious. Went to yeshiva, was learning there, taught. Later, I went to Israel. He made me a lecture by his parents' house. I spoke there for 4 hours. The guy told me today, I met this guy, and he told me that you did not make him religious. He just came to one of your lectures. This is what we're talking about. Kfuyei tova. People that are ungrateful. The minute he met me, he didn't know one thing from Judaism. He did not even know who's Avraham Avinu. That's how much ignorant he was. He sat for 4 hours in a lecture. He saw that the Torah is divine. He came the entire Shabbat and listened non-stop Divrei Torah. I took him to a seminar, made him a frum person. He went to yeshiva, I even recommended him which yeshiva to go. He became a very famous person today in religion. And now he comes to this person, he says, I just went to one of his lectures. This is exactly what we're talking about. Anashim, people that are kfuyei tova. Someone gets married, his in-laws helping him, 10 years or 20 years later, what did they do for me? It's nothing, it's not the way it was. Someone who taught you Torah in yeshiva when you were young, it's nothing. He takes too much credit for himself. This is 99% of the people. 99% of the people. And those are people who break the main principle of Judaism. One of the things to be a kosher Jew is always to be grateful. It can never be kfui tova. If somebody asks you, how you define Judaism in one word? The answer is mode. Mode means I admit that that's the truth. And mode means thank you. One word, two different meanings. One is ani mode, I admit. And two, I thank you. That's what Judaism is all about. I always stick to the truth. I'm not a politician. One day I'm like this, one day I'm like that. This person is my friend, so I take his side. That person, I don't know him, so I go against him. That's not how I go. I check what was told to me. It's true, I'm with it. If it's a lie, I'm against it. I give you an example. Rav Ovadia Yosef, he was the biggest Faradi rabbi of the generation. One of the biggest in 100 years in the whole world. Brilliant, wrote many, many books, was a powerful leader, made a revolution in the Sfaradi world. I don't have to present him to you. I'm sure you all know what I'm talking about. He was very much against wigs. Some rabbis allowed their people to wear wigs. He was very much against it. In a lot of his speeches, he spoke very much against it. Everybody knew Chacham Ovadia is very much against wigs. One time, as he was speaking against wigs, one idiot in the crowd got up in front of everybody. That's what happens when people are brainless. They do stupid things. He got up in front of the most important Chacham, mamash, like embarrassing him in public. He gets in front of everyone and he said to him, Kvod Arav, he always speaks against wigs. But I see your daughter-in-law, the wife of your son, is walking in the street with a wig. You can't go after the lecture quietly and ask such a question. You must embarrass him in public. That's what happened when you're stupid. So what was the answer of the rabbi? He said, there is enough room in Gehenom for her as well. And she eats in his Shabbat table. He's going to see her in 2 days. He's going to sit in his face. In front of everyone, he answered to him, the Torah is not for stranger, but not for my relatives. If that's the truth, it applies to my daughter and my daughter-in-law and my brother and everybody else. There's no politician here. No politics. We stick to the truth. We say what's the truth. Sometimes you like it. Sometimes you don't. But that's the truth. That's how was Rav Shach, and that was many leaders. Rav Avigdor Miller was a perfect example. Never ever something came out of his mouth flattering the wicked, or he was a politician. One time he said like this, tomorrow he changed his mind a little bit because there were different people over there. It was not such thing. Always speak to the truth. And second, no matter what someone does for you, always thank you, thank you, thank you, a million thank you. Appreciate it. I'll never forget it. If 10 years later he needs a favor, you run. What can I do for you? Rav Shach one time, he said to his assistant, Schaik, Rav Schaik, take me to a cemetery somewhere in Israel. It was a pouring rain, pouring storm. They couldn't hold the umbrella. He said, okay, wait over here, let me go, I will be right back. He went into the cemetery, was reading, praying over there for about half an hour, came back into the car all wet, and he said to him, who is this person here? I never saw you coming to this cemetery. He said to him, when I was back in Europe, I was a teenager. By now he was in his 90s. When this story happened, when I was a teenager, I had only one shirt. I was very poor. I had only one white shirt. And when I needed to do laundry, I had to go to the lake and hide while I'm taking it off and washing it in a lake. I have to wait a few hours that the shirt will dry. So I had to hide for a few hours until it's going to dry and I wear it a little bit wet. Because I had only one shirt. One time a woman passed by and she saw that I sit in a corner learning without a shirt. So she told me, young boy, why are you sitting in such weather? It was colder. Why are you sitting over here without a shirt? So I have only one shirt. I just washed it and I'm waiting for it to dry. So she said, I have a shirt to give you. She went, she came back and gave him one shirt. And he said, thanks to this woman, now when I needed to wash one shirt, I had something else to wear. So I didn't have to sit there and wait. I would hang it and go and come back after a few hours and get it. So this was 80 years later. And every year he used to go into the grave of this woman in Israel and read Tehillim for her. You understand what it means, gratefulness? We have no idea what gratefulness is. In this parasha, Parashat Shmot, there is something amazing, scary. The Torah speaks about Paro. Paro, Yosef HaTzadik saved Mitzrayim, saved Egypt. After the, you know, he told Paro it's going to be 7 good years and then 7 years of hunger. Store all the food, prepare for the future. He made Egypt. All the money in the world came to Egypt. Yosef was in charge of the money for 80 years, from age 30 to age 110, until he died. All the money in the world needs his signature. You want to get flour, you want to get seeds, you want to get sesame, you want to get wheat and barley, you need Yosef's approval. How much to send to this, how much to that? He took all their homes. He gave them property and they had to pay 20% to Paro. It was a brilliant finance minister, the best in the history of the world. And Yosef passed away, and the Torah says, Vayakom Melech Hadash, Asher lo yada et Yosef. This Paro became, he had leprosy. He had leprosy, he was sick, he could not be a king. Then, when he came back into his chair, he pretended that he doesn't know Yosef. The Torah says, hey, Paro was an ungrateful king. He already forgot what Yosef did for him and for Egypt. So the Gemara is talking about this. The Chachamim ask a question. Paro was ungrateful? Paro was a mass murderer. He murdered thousands of babies, throwing them into the water. What's worse, to be Hitler or to be an ungrateful person? Everybody you ask, I said, what's the comparison here? This person take babies and throw them into the water and they choke to death. And this person is ungrateful. He doesn't remember a favor that someone did for him. And you compare between them? The answer is yes, because ungrateful is even worse than mass murderer. That's why the Torah does not say Paro is wicked because he's a murderer. Paro is wicked because he's ungrateful. I'll give you another example. Everything we do, we learn from the Torah. We don't mix our own opinion. The Torah say to Moshe, Hashem say to Moshe, Egyptians that torture you in Egypt, in the camps, they killed your babies, they made you work 16 hours a day, they used to beat you up, they took away your homes, your money, everything. Three generations cannot convert. Paro and his son, up to the time of his grandson, from then on, you can accept them to become Jewish. They want to convert, you can convert them. But there are two nations, you can never convert them. Never. Who? Ammon and Moab. Lo yavo Ammoni u'Moavi bik'al Hashem. Even 10 generations later, you can never ever convert these two nations. Why? Because they are ungrateful people. I do not want ungrateful people in my nation. The chosen people, we don't want to open the door for them. Why Ammon and Moab are ungrateful? Because 10 generations ago, Avraham Avinu saved his nephew Lot. Remember Lot? That the Hashem sent the angel to Sodom, to San Francisco of those days. And he said, get ready, I'm burning everyone here. All the wicked people, all the gays are all going to be on fire. But you, we're going to save you. But not thanks to you. We are saving you thanks to your uncle, Avraham Avinu. Hashem does not want him to be upset that his nephew will die like this. So thanks to Avraham, you are being saved. So as they took Lot out, lots of fire are falling all over Sodom, and all the wicked people were going on fire, screaming, thousands of them going on fire, running on the street, getting burned. He saw what's going on. Actually, his wife turned around. He wasn't allowed to look back. The angel told him, don't look back. Everyone would look back to see what happened to these wicked people. We'll go with them. And his wife turned around and she became a pillar of salt, the Torah say. And Lot was afraid because he saw what happened to his wife. So they continued to walk. The Torah say, what does Hashem care if Lot will see how the wicked people get burned or not? It's actually more. It's actually is going to make you more religious. If you see all your friends from Sodom, your friends from Manhattan and from San Francisco, all the gay neighbors, what happened to them, it will make you be much, much stronger, never ever to think to be like them after you saw their end. So why did Hashem say you don't have the right to look? If you look at them, you'll die with them. The answer is, because one of the prizes that Hashem reserved for the righteous people is to see the end and the punishment of the wicked people. That's a prize. You can't take it for granted. It's not, you don't take it unless you deserve it. And the angel told Lot, you are nothing better than them. You came to live with them, you became like them. You even went to their court to be their judge. Because you left Avraham Avinu, you became like them. You only get saved thanks to Avraham, not because you are tzaddik. So you don't have the right to look at their end. You don't have the right to look at the end of all these wicked people, what they do today, what you see in the media every day with Trump and everything. When the time will come to see their end and what Hashem will give them, not everyone will have the merit to see it. Only those who were not like them, those who condemned them, those who stayed away from their wicked way, they will have the merit to see the destruction of the wicked people. That's what the Torah say. And that's what's written, that in heaven there is ashes running under the legs of the righteous people always. The Gemara asks, why there is ashes running on the floor all the time? If everybody there enjoying the Torah of Hashem, the soul is in the highest level of pleasure, why would you have to look at ashes on the floor? Why? The answer is, there is a pasuk that Hashem says, I'm going to make all the wicked people ashes under your legs, that you will look down and you will see that what would be my end if I was not righteous. Will always remind you what it could have been if you were Mechalel Shabbat, and if you were a thief, if you were not a modest person, you would be one of them. So that will remind you how lucky you are that you can be with Hashem, attached to his holiness, and remember what could have happened to you. That's a prize that Hashem is reserving for the righteous people. Now going back to what I say, Ammon and Moab, after 10 generations, that Abraham saved Lot. Lot was sure that the whole world died. He didn't know it's only Sodom and Gomorrah. He thought probably God burned the whole world. So he said, it's only me and my two daughters. No more people left. The daughter said, if we will not become pregnant now, that's it. We're going to die and the world will be empty forever. Let's get our father drunk and become pregnant from him. He won't be aware that it's his daughters. At least there will be people in the world. So they both conceived from their own father, the Torah say. One called her son Ammon, Me'ami. It's boy from my own nation, meaning my father. She hides it. The other one called her son Moav, Me'av, a son of my father. Meaning the second one was foolish. She didn't hide it. The first one say for my nation. Doesn't have to be for my father. The other one say for my father. Those two boys became a nation. They became a whole nation. Later they found out that not all the goyim died, only the people of Sodom. They had wives, they became pregnant, and two nations came out of them. A whole nation. Now the Bnei Israel needs to have a shortcut from their land. They have to pass by their land. They ask them permission. Let us walk through your property. They say, no. The Torah say, Hashem said to Moshe, because they did not run to give you water and bread. I'm not asking them to give you Bukhari and delicious gujguje or svo. None of these things. Only water and bread. How much it cost to give a person one pita that they bake anyway on their own? What is it, 10 cents? Water, it's nothing. So you had to give $1 per person to the nation that thanks to them you are alive. Without their father Avraham Avinu, you would never get saved. You wouldn't have life. You wouldn't have what you have. But not only you did not run to give them food and water, you are actually against them. People like you can never be Jewish. Well, I don't want, even after 10 generations, that one of you will ever convert. This is only applied to the men. Well, women can become Jewish, like Ruth Moavia. She came from Moab, and David HaMelech came from Ruth. And Mashiach came from her. So the Gemara asks, why Ruth HaMoavia, why she converted? She's also from the nation of Moab. The Torah says, women must always be modest. It's not modest for a woman that to go out to the street and come to strangers and offer them food. Why? It can give the men all kinds of ideas. Ooh, maybe she likes me. Look, she came, she gave me food. It doesn't look good. It's not modest. Because the women did not go, they didn't get punished. But all the male that was supposed to bring the food out, because they did not give the nation of Israel food, they were ungrateful. Hashem said they can never be Jewish. Now let's do the calculation. The Egyptians were nothing better than the Nazis. They kill our babies, they took away everything we had, they put us in camps. Hashem say they can become Jewish. The murderers, the cruel Egyptians, after 2-3 generations, they can become Jewish. Why? They gave you a place to sleep in a time of hunger. When you came to Egypt, Paro say you can go to Eretz Goshen. Yosef, give them food. You had a place to live. But they killed us after that. If somebody gave you a place to live, you lived there for a few years, and then he came with a knife and stuck it in your back and killed you, you owe him gratitude? Believe it or not, just for the few years he took care of you, you have to be grateful. So the Egyptians that killed us, but they gave us a place to sleep and food to eat, Hashem say, after 2 generations, Paro and his son, the murderers, will die. The grandchildren and all, they can convert to Judaism. But these ungrateful nations, they did not murder anyone. They didn't come with guns to kill you, with knives. But because they did not give you bread and water, they are ungrateful people. Ungrateful people, I do not want in my nation. What about proud people? Let's read what Hashem thinks about almost every one of us. Who can raise his hand here and say he doesn't have high ego? Anyone? You see, you're very clever. You know it's a catch-22. If you raise your hand right away, it's a sign that you're not humble. Because a real humble person, if they ask, who is not proud here? Me. So he's the most proud person. So whatever you do, it's bad. Okay? If you don't raise your hand, that means you admit that you are proud. And if you raise your hand, you also admit you are proud. But let's see what the Torah says. Midat HaGava. This book, it's called Orchot Tzadikim, the way of the righteous, is the most important Musar book in Jewish history. It was written close to 1,000 years ago. Everything we know about personality characters come from here. Many other books that were written, that's the base, that's the foundation. Let's, the first page, first chapter speaks about pride. Why pride? Because that's the worst. We'll start from the worst thing that a person can have. Let's see. The gava, pride. It's forbidden by the king of the world. He warned us in the Torah, be careful that you should never forget your God, because a proud person will always forget his creator. As it's written, uvkarcha vetzoncha irbeyun vechesev vezahav irbelach. You will have tons of cattle, you will have gold and silver, you become wealthy, veram levavcha, you become proud because you became more and more rich, veshachachta et Hashem Elokecha, and you will forget your God. And what will happen to you? Veamarta bilvavcha, kochi ve'otzem yadi asali et hachayil hazeh. Do you know why I'm rich? Because I'm smart, not like you, stupid. You know why I'm rich? Because I went to university and invested 6 years. That's why I became a great doctor. Do you know why I'm rich? Because I work extra hours. You know why I'm rich? Because I did this and I did that and I joined this guy and everyone with his story. The answer is, do you know why I'm rich? Because I'm a complete loser, but Hashem wanted to give me a gift. That's the truth. I'm not smart, and I'm not educated, and I'm not Talmid Chacham, and I'm not brilliant, and I'm not a hardworking person, and I have no idea what I'm doing. The things that I thought gonna make me the most money, I lost. And the thing that I did not have any faith in, that's where I made my millions. And I can give you hundreds of people that will tell you the same thing. I lost here, and I lost here, and I lost here. And in the end, Hashem sent me that goy, and that goy gave me this idea. And thanks to that, I made all my money. This is what one of the richest Jews in the world, his son, told me. He told me, you know how we made all our money? We had a store. We were making a living. And then Hashem sent us an old goy who gave my father and my uncle this idea. And we started to follow his idea, and they became multi-billionaires. They have tens of billions of dollars. And thanks to that old goy that gave them the idea, whatever the idea was. So that's how they made all the money. Why? Because Hashem wanted them to make money. He sent them the right person. How many people made fortune in the stock market because they got the right person who knows about stocks? Millions of others took the wrong ones and only lost for the money. And this guy, someone told him, give the money to this guy, he's going to make you money, and he made you fortune. Why? Because Hashem wanted it. Not because you're smart, not because you understand about stocks, nothing. Nothing whatsoever. So the Torah continues, "V'zacharta et Hashem Elokecha." You remember your God, Ki Hu anoten lecha koach la'asot chayim. He is the one who gives you the ability to succeed. Nobody else. So remember, next time when you think because you are educated you rich, don't think like this. This is heresy. That's kfirah. If you think you marry a rich girl and thanks to her father you became rich, it's heresy. If you think you're rich because you're strong and you work very hard, it's heresy. If you think you're rich because you know how to play basketball and you went to the NBA, it's nonsense. There are plenty of other black guys in Harlem that were playing much better than you, and they cleaned the streets of Manhattan today. None of them became Michael Jordan because this one got lucky that he went to the same place and the right person saw him and offered him a job, and he became who became. And like him, there were 1,000 other talented black players, not less than him, but nobody looked at them because they didn't have the merit to become multimillionaires. That's all. That's what's going on. Sometimes you have a very talented player, he play a year or two, gets such injury, and his career is over. And there's somebody that is not as great, he was healthy for 20 years and made millions. Why? Everybody makes what God wants him to make. Remember this. And this is the beginning of you should not ever be proud. What comes next? King, the king of Israel. A king is allowed to be proud or no? He walks with a crown, fancy clothes, fancy carriage, bodyguards, soldiers, palace. Should he be the king? Allowed to be proud or no? The Torah say the king must walk with the Sefer Torah everywhere he goes. That he should learn in a Sefer Torah daily. Because if he won't learn Torah, he will feel greater than the rest of the nation. He will be proud. If he will learn Torah, the Torah will make him humble. Anav, lebilti rum levavo meechav. I don't want the king ever to think that he's better than anybody else in the country. You are a king because you were born to the right father, not because you're smart and nothing else. And or the nation decided that you be the king because Hashem wanted it. Nothing else. It's not thanks to you. Now, the gava, you can divide it as the pride, you can divide to two different categories. One is a person that is proud about his look, and the second is a person that is proud about his talent. Look and talent. Let's see. When a person feels proud, the pride will take over your entire life. It just makes you a prisoner. And then what? It's written, Yan ki gavru bnot Zion vatelechna netiuyot garon. There were Jewish girls. There were Jewish girls 2,600 years ago, in the time of Prophet Yeshayahu, Prophet Isaiah. They used to walk in the street, you know? Not only that, if she was not so tall, she would stretch her head to look tall. If she's tall, she makes sure to have two short friends, and she walks in the middle, that everybody will realize that she's tall. If she's alone, they used to put bells in their legs. You know how the when you walk, the bells will make noise? Automatically everybody looks, because she wants everyone to see how beautiful she is, and nobody looks. But automatically when a person hears bells, immediately he looks. That's what they used to do. So what happened? There was a daughter of Rabbi Hanina ben Tradion, one of the Asara Aruge Malchut. It was one of the biggest rabbis in the whole world. She was taken by the Romans, Lo Aleno, to be a prostitute. Imagine the daughter of the biggest rabbi in the world, the Romans kidnapped her, they put her in some place with prostitute, Goyot. Why did she get such a punishment, the Gemara asked. Why would the daughter of the biggest rabbi in the world would be kidnapped and become a prostitute by the Goyim, by the Romans? It's a big tragedy, worse than death penalty. If you ask the rabbi, what would you prefer? That your daughter, Chas v'Shalom, will die? Or she will be kidnapped and be a prostitute by the Goyim somewhere in Italy? What would he answer if he's normal? Better she die and go to heaven than to be Chas v'Shalom with all this filth. Why did she get such a punishment, the Gemara said? Not me, the Gemara. One time she walked in front of Roman soldiers and ministers. Important, rich Romans. And she heard that they say, Kama na'ot psiyotea shel rivazo. How beautiful this woman, and look how she walks. You know? This is in Masechet Avodah Zarah, page 18. You can see the story over there. And then once they started to talk about her beauty and now how nice she walks, she tried to walk even nicer. Instead of being embarrassed that the Goyim are looking at her and she attracts attention by all these filthy soldiers, she actually walked even nicer to attract more attention from strangers on the street, which unfortunately many women today that call themselves religious do on a daily basis. She did it once, that's it, one time. And because of that, HaKadosh Baruch Hu gave her such a punishment, Lo Aleinu, that she ended up in such a place, the worst thing that you can imagine. Why is it? Pride. Just because I made you pretty doesn't mean you have to run and show your beauty on the streets. The other way around. The beauty was meant for your husband, for him to enjoy from it. That's it. Nobody else. Rabbi Victor Miller has a whole speech about it. A religious woman has to do everything she can not to be seen when she walks to public. Today it's the other way around. When they go out to the supermarket, Jose, Antonio, Amigo, you know, all these Goyim, the Puerto Rican and Guatemala and El Salvador, she makes a fashion show for them. ¿Qué pasa, amigo? ¿Cómo está? Oh, senora. But when her husband come home, after all day begging people to buy some jewelry in 47th Street, finally he's dying already, shows up 8 o'clock, shmate over here, all the face oily from frying the eggplant, this, wow, Moshe, I had such a hard day, I'm not in a mood. What happened? She was busy in the supermarket 3 hours ago to show her beauty. To whom? To Ahmed, to Mustafa, to whom? Everything is the other way around today. The Torah say to Ahmed and Mustafa, you gotta make sure they don't even know who you are. Hide yourself. Don't make any eye contact with them. But when your husband come home, put a fashion show, nice clothes, you have a lot of perfume. Use it for your husband, not for amigos in a restaurant or in the supermarket. But today, it's the other way around. One girl once told me, I'm very offended in what you just said. I said, what did I just say? Which one? She said, you already assume that every woman who puts beauty on herself to go out to the public is because she wants to be seen by the man. I don't do it for the man. I do it for myself. I want to feel good with myself. Very convincing. So I told her, oh yeah, just for yourself? She said, absolutely. What do you think? I want people to look at me? No, I want to feel good before I leave the house. It makes me feel great. So I say to her, you almost convinced me, but there's one problem. Let's imagine you would be on a flight with a bunch of people and your plane landed an emergency landing in an island. Everyone around you died and you are the only survivor on a plane. And you have your makeup box, you know, your bag, with all the powders and lipsticks and eyeliner and this for the hair.
What does she have to do?
Wait, now she's alone in the island. She's alone. I say to her, you come out, you come out, you look around, you see monkeys, elephants, lions, snakes. Everyone looks at you, the monkeys, the baboons. Now you're alone in the island, that's it. Who knows how many years you're gonna be here by yourself. Now, first morning you woke up, will you invest 20 to 30 minutes to do your hair, to fix your makeup for the monkeys and for the snakes? She said, obviously not. So here you go. You see that you're not doing it for yourself to feel good with yourself? You are doing it for the man to get your attention. And that's, by the way, some women, if you connect them to a lie detector, and you ask them, do you put a show for the men on the street? They would say no. Connect them to the lie detector, and the lie detector will show that they're saying the truth. How come? So who's right? The lie detector or me? Who's right? I'm always right. No. I'll tell you why I'm right here. Why I'm right? Because even these women, she really believed that she does it to feel good with herself. But from her subconscious, the only reason is for the men. And how do you know? You need to know body language. Body language. For instance, there is a girl that was offered a shidduch, a guy. She did not show that she's interested. You know how these women who play hard to get? So she's, it's this, it's that, it's family. Don't offer it. I say to her mother, she's dying for it to happen. I said, no, but she's very tough, you know. I said to her, believe me, I see from her body language. One time the guy came for Shabbat with a bunch of guys. What did the girl did? Usually, she comes to the Shabbat table, no makeup, no nothing, her hair is picked up together. She's not wearing her best dress. When she found out that this guy will come, she did it to feel good with herself. Why is it? After that, he would come and say to her, why are you putting such a show? You usually don't do that. The answer is, maybe she's not even aware of it, but it comes from the subconscious. This is how we all are. We all like this. Many times rabbis, I've seen big rabbis, Talmidei Chachamim, as soon as they saw a billionaire coming to the area, how their entire body language is changing. Completely. Different people. Why? Because everybody with his thoughts, with his hopes, with his expectations, even when you won't admit it, it affects you subconsciously. Now, let's give few examples. The Torah said to the Jews, "Ve'avdil etchem min ha'amim." I separated you from all the nations. You cannot be like the rest of the nations. The Baalei Gava. Now, pay attention carefully. People that have pride, they are despicable in the eyes of God. Metoavim Be'enei Hashem. The Torah used the word to'eva for what? Who knows? The Torah, abomination. When does the Torah use the word abomination? To which criminals? One, idol worshippers. People who bow down to idols. Two, gays. Gays. Three, proud people. Sometimes you come to a religious person, you talk to him about this guy is doing all kinds of crimes, this guy is an idol worshipper, this guy is gay. Ugh, Rasha'im, they're so wicked, these people, I don't want anything to do with them. But he's nothing better than them. Because he knows a lot of Torah, and he's full of himself. Everywhere he goes, he sees who's rising, who's this, who's respecting him, who's not. How they write his title and the brochures. Because he's full of ego. That's why he always wants a special place to sit and always dress special things and will always have a special hat and will always make sure that people write about him that he's a Rav HaGaon, the genius one. Someone that is humble, the last thing he worry about is this. I'll give you an example. Rav Ben Zion Abba Shaul Zatzal was the biggest chacham on earth and the biggest mekubal. What happened? One time he was learning in yeshiva, and there was a wedding with one of the boys. Everybody left, and he left there with one or two guys. And he asked, anybody goes to the wedding of this boy? One guy said, I go, Kvod HaRav. He said, can I come with you in your car? He said to him, of course, Kvod HaRav, but I don't have a car. I have a scooter. You know, but not a scooter with a boat. You know the old days they used to have scooter, you have a scooter and attached to it there is another seat on the side. You don't see it already 40 years, it's out of the world. That's how it used to be. So you're sitting in a box, your head is out, it looks like a convertible. But you sit in a plastic box, attached to the scooter. So Rav Ben Zion didn't know what this Vespa is. So he said, what is this, it drives? He said, yes. Okay, so let me go. So they came out downstairs, he saw, he looked at that, he didn't feel anything is wrong. Kvod HaRav sit here, he sat over there, and they start driving in Yerushalayim. So they stop in the light, all the people of Yerushalayim, they look at the most holy, big, genius rabbi in the whole world, they look at him, wow, it's Rav Ben Zion, Rav Ben Zion Abba Shaul, oh my gosh, what is he doing like this in a Vespa? Now he did not understand that something here is wrong, driving in such a thing for such an important rabbi. But when he started to realize all the people looking at him and get shocked, all of a sudden he yelled, stop! The guy stopped, he came out of the Vespa, and he started to cry on the street like this. He was crying. He asked him, what happened, rabbi? He said, I'm the Av Bet Din, I'm of the head of the Bet Din of Yerushalayim. I made a big Chilul Hashem now. He said, why you made Chilul Hashem? He didn't do anything wrong. He said, I did not understand that to drive in this Vespa, it's something out of the ordinary. Now when I realize how people reacted, I understand that I embarrassed the title of the Torah. You understand? But he was so humble, he did not have a problem sitting in a Vespa. He used to take buses. Everybody begged him to serve him, and he did not want anything from anyone. He did not even open his own yeshiva, because he did not want to take money from the rich people. All his life, he refused to open a yeshiva. The most important chacham in the world, he teach in Porat Yosef. Why don't you open your own yeshiva? I don't want to go to rich people and tell them, give me money. He did not want. Why? He's very down to earth, very humble. So, let's see what Hashem thinks about people that are proud. Ba'alei gaava hem metoavim be'enei Hashem. As it's written in Proverbs 16, verse 5, Mishlei tetzayin pasuke, to'avat Hashem kol gval lev. Everyone that is proud is despicable to'eva in the eyes of Hashem. Even if he's a very big Talmid Chacham. Even if he's a king, even if he's a doctor, doesn't matter who you are. You have pride, you are despicable. Just like the gay and just like the idol worshiper. No difference. This is a divine Torah, it's not my opinion. So yeah, therefore, next time you see this important Rosh Yeshiva, and you see this gay from Shenkin in Tel Aviv with earring over here, dressed like a woman, and somebody asks you who is better, somebody you compare him to him, you're normal, maybe in the eyes of Hashem there's no difference. He's Toeva, and he's Toeva. Why? Because if you learn Torah all your life, first rule in the Torah is be down to earth. Why did Hashem give Moshe Rabbeinu the job? He was stuttering. A leader has to know how to talk. He wants to say something, he gets stuck. That's not exactly a charismatic leader. Look now, Sleepy Joe. He goes to Florida and he says, hello, Michigan. He doesn't remember the opponent. He called Trump something else. I don't know how he called him, Billy. In the middle of debate, huh?
George.
Listen, George. So he doesn't know how to talk, he makes mistakes. We had one like this in Israel, Gantz. Every time he talks to someone, he calls him a different name. He gets stuck, he gets confused, words don't come out of his mouth. People made fun of them. But Moshe Rabbeinu was stuttering. Nobody made fun of him. Moshe said to Hashem, why you want to send me to Paro to take the Jewish nation out? I don't have a power of speech. It's going to embarrass you if I will be the representative. So Hashem said to Moshe, I don't get you. Who gave a mouth to the human being to be able to talk? Me. Don't you think that I will put the right words in your mouth? You don't give me a little credit that it's all in my hand? That I really need your talent to take the Jewish nation out? The only reason I send you is because I love you. And the only reason I love you is because you are down to earth. You're the most humble person in the whole world. That's why I love you. Not because you're the smartest, not you're not the richest, none of this. You only Moshe Rabbeinu because you are humble. And that's why the Torah will be named after you. Zichru Torat Moshe Avdi. Ve'aish Moshe Anav Mikol Adam. It's written in the Torah. Now the Torah continues. On what incident it happened? Where does it say such thing? I have to check. Ach belibo, someone that is proud only in his heart. He won't dare to put people down. He will never say I'm better than him. He will never speak bad about people that are not as great as him. But he's only feeling in his heart, I'm better than everyone around me. I'm the best, I'm the smartest, I'm the richest. I am and me. But he never say it outside of his mouth. Only in his mind. It's also abomination. Gam ken nikra toeva. Shenemar toavat Hashem kol gvalev. Someone that is proud in his heart is toeva. Needless to say, in actions, in his words. That's even worse. The Torah continue. Lo tavi toeva el betecha. If you bring a proud person into your house, Hashem leaves the house. Why? You already have a different God. You don't need me. He thinks he's a God. I can't come there. Why? Because this person thinks he's running the world. Ve'en afaron ninar, does not resurrect in a resurrection of the dead. Someone that has ego. Ve'ashchina me'alelet alav. Hashem is crying on that Jew every day. How he's going to lose everything because of his bad personality, character, traits. Amar HaKadosh Baruch Hu, En ani ve'hu yecholim ladur ba'olam. Me and him cannot be in the same place. It's either him or me. Shenemar, as it's written, Gva enayim urechav levav oto lo uchal. Someone that look at everyone down, his eyes are up, or his nose is up, and he feels great about himself, that he's better than anyone, I cannot stand him. I cannot stand him. That's pasuk. You want the source? It's Tehillim 101. Gematria Michael. Psalms 101. That's the verse. Verse 5. Gva enayim urechav levav, oto lo uchal. I can't stand him. Everyone that has ego and pride, I can't stand him. So next time, when you think you're the best, think again. Better you start telling yourself 5,000 times a week, I'm nothing, I'm nothing, I'm nothing, I'm nothing. David HaMelech say, V'anochi tola'at velo ish. I'm a worm, I'm not even a person. Avraham Avinu say, Anochi afar va'efer. I'm dust and sand. Nothing greater than that. Moshe Rabbeinu and Aaron say, V'nachnu ma. We are nothing. Not even a worm. Not even dust. Nothing. The greatest people in the history, they say that they are nothing. And they believed it. I can also say I'm nothing. The question is, do I really believe it or not? If I believe it, I'm perfect tzaddik. Then Hashem would also put me in a Tanakh. But so far, to the best of my knowledge, my name is not in a Tanakh. Moshe Rabbeinu is in the Torah. David HaMelech is in the Tanakh. Moshe and Aaron are in the Torah. Avraham Avinu is in the Torah. And the Torah say that they are humbled. And it's written that they say that they are nothing, and it's in the book of Hashem. If it was a lie, Hashem does not put lies in his book. If Moshe Rabbeinu would say, I'm nothing, and he would think, I am something, he would not read about it in the Torah, and Hashem would not say that he's the most humble person. If David HaMelech say, I'm a worm, and he didn't believe that he's a worm, you would not read about it in the book of Shmuel. Why you read about it? Because it's 100% the truth. And the more, the greater you are, the more humble you should be. Because you know that still compared to Hashem, you are really nothing. Let's give another example. Someone that Yahir, someone that is proud, even the people of his family cannot stand him. Sometimes you call the house of a man, his own children cannot stand him. You see by the way they answer the phone, by the way they call him, or by the way they answer, that they got very upset now that they have to waste time looking for him. So you see from their body language. The Torah says, someone that is arrogant and proud, afilu al anshe betelo mitkabel. The people of his home, when he tells them, I'm going on a business trip, everyone is happy. Ah, shtabach shemo, 3 days of vacation from him. Why? Everything like a ruler. You know why? Full of ego. Pride make a person money hungry. He wants a lot of money because that will help him to express his pride. If he's poor, what is it going to help him that he's proud? He can't buy anything. If he's going to have a lot of money, he's going to buy fancy cars, fancy watches, fancy clothes, will go to fancy places. Everything by him will be fancy. Like this, he can express his pride. But if he doesn't have money, the pride is worthless. What can I do with that? Nobody would look at you. So automatically it makes a person greedy. When a person becomes money hungry, the next step, he become a crook because Hashem wants to give him $100,000 a year, but it's not enough. How is he going to buy a mansion in Beverly Hills with $100,000 a year? How is he going to buy a Bentley? It's not going to be what he wants. So he begin to cheat from here, steal from there, take merchandise and don't pay. That's what he does. And a lot of the business people are not honest in their businesses. And the reason that they're not honest, not because they don't have enough food to eat, because it's not enough to express their desires. If I'm going to live simple life, what kind of life I'm going to have? I can't show myself anywhere. I can't wear the fancy clothes I'm dreaming about. I cannot buy the fancy jewelry I like. Life is not going to be what I want it to be. And one thing leads to another. So a person, no matter how rich he is, should wear average clothes. Nobody told you have to wear a $10,000 suit, even if you have millions. Wear an average normal suit. I don't know, $200-$300, normal, fine, look okay, no problem. Watch, nice watch. Doesn't have to be a $50,000 watch with diamonds. Baloney, it's a show-off. It's not gonna make the watch better. It's just a show-off. Some kind of name. Patek Philippe, $200,000 watch. What's in it, diamonds? Not exactly, it's a name. So somebody spends so much money on that, why? Because once he walk with that, everybody bow down. So what the watch he has? What does he need it for? If he would take the $200,000 and give it to someone that makes Baalei Tshuva or to a kosher yeshiva, he will make trillions of mitzvot. Now he only makes sins with this watch. Everywhere he go, he shows up, he go, you know? Oh, if she has a nice diamond when she goes to places, wow, it's such a hot day. Why hot day? Why? Well, she wants everyone to know this ring. The Gemara say women should not wear their jewelry in Reshut HaRabim b'Shabbat. Why? If you have a watch, you can walk with that in the street. If you have a wedding ring, simple wedding ring, you can walk with that on Shabbat. Why you do not want fancy jewelry on a woman on Shabbat? Because it's guaranteed that she will take it out for her friend to try it on. Can I try it on? Yes, of course. Wow, she feels so great. Oh, she's dying. She wishes she can have the same. That's the stupidity of people. But we have to remember, Hashem doesn't like this. If we have Yirat Shamayim, we will suppress our desires. Why don't you wear the most expensive one? Why should I? Because you can afford it. I'd rather take my money and invest it for the Olam Haba, not a show-off. I know one guy in Monsi, he has 10 yeshivot in Israel that him and his brother sponsor. All 10 yeshivot. You have to see his home. The most simple home in Monsi. You'd never believe that this guy is a billionaire. He owns buildings, this, but he looks himself like a bachur yeshiva. Where does he put all his money? To help people. One time there was a family in Israel. They had a boy that needed to be treated in Philadelphia for cancer. He rented for them a house in Monsi for 1 year, paid all the expenses, got them a car, gave them enough money to live for the whole year. It was over $100,000 it cost him to help them to come to here, that they should take their sons to the hospitals over there every week, back and forth. Everything he paid for them. And I was laughing because the house he rented for them was much nicer than his house. People like this, Hashem is very happy with. Very happy. Why? It's not about me, everything. It's about what Hashem wants. Let's give another example. He will not try to be always unique. You know how some people that full of ego, everything by them must be unique. Unique! Everyone get married in a catering hall, he must find the most exotic garden. Why? Show off. What for? Only one reason, pride and show off. That's why we have to be careful. Secular people, what do they know from their life? They don't learn Torah, they don't learn this. But people that are religious, they gotta be very, very careful to be down to earth. A person should not run after extra delicious food. Food should not be the center of your life. A person should not look for fancy utensils. I one time went to do Shabbaton by a house of a very rich person. He was serving food with gold plates, original 24 carats gold, and glasses, crystal and gold, very expensive. I heard someone say that every glass, this was 15 years ago, each glass like this cost $2,500. So I had a little boy, and my boy is holding this glass, and every second he's gonna knock it on the floor and break it. I can see it already. Yeah. So I took it away from him, and I went to the kitchen. I said to the Spanish servant, can you give me a plastic cup? So I brought a plastic cup, I gave it to my little boy, and this billionaire came, what is this plastic cup on the table? How did it get here? I said, I brought it from the kitchen for the boy. Why? I said, I'm afraid he's gonna break the glass. Let him break the glass. It's lichvot Shabbat. Tough. No problem. You want him to break the glass? Take the glass. Baruch Hashem didn't break the glass. But you don't need all this. You don't need. This is not the way of the Torah. This is the way of the kings, of the goyim. Okay. Now, person should make sure always to be clean. Not sweaty, not oily hair, not danger of all over your shoulders. You gotta be clean. You have to rinse your mouth. You have to brush your teeth. You have to make sure not to eat raw garlic when you go out to the street. Yes, some people, everything they eat, tons of raw garlic. Then they go up, hey, how are you? Person faint. I have a guy, every time he walks towards me on Shabbat, I say, Gadal v'itkadash merab. As soon as he's gonna come 2 steps by me, he's gonna kill me with his breath. Why? He likes raw garlic. Someone told him, if you eat raw garlic, you live to 150. So everybody around him has to suffer. That's Chilul Hashem. You go, you learn in yeshiva, person all day has to smell you. I cannot even smell a person that smoke. I want to vomit. If someone just smoke and he speaks to me, I suffer genom. Why? I don't smoke. I hate it. I wonder always how women that don't smoke, they're able to function with someone that smoke. All the clothes full of cigarettes, the house. I don't know how they do it. They deserve a big prize. Next thing. The pride is when a person look down at people. Everybody looks like nothing for him. He prays himself everywhere he go. He prays his traits. Everything he has and the others don't have, he always talk about. Or about his brilliance. King Solomon say, a person should never praise himself. Let others praise you. But you should never praise yourself. Someone that is proud will always think that everybody owes him. If they put you in a wedding in a corner with your back to the band, what would you do? 20 years you don't talk to this person anymore. What happened? You hate your cousin so much. You know what he did to me? This chatzuf, such an ungrateful guy. You know, when I got married, I put him in a VIP area. He put me in a corner like a dog. My back to the camera, I couldn't see the Bukharian singer. I had to look around, my neck hurt for 2 weeks after that. Why? If you're down to earth, none of this shtuyot you will care about. You know these people that come to the wedding with an open check? After they inspect the place, they decide what amount to write. Why? Mevaker Amdina. Then a person that is busy with his own honor and lo kvod shamayim. Hashem doesn't play a role here. I'm Hashem. Rather give somebody else respect. It's hard for him to respect Hashem. He wants the whole world to praise him. When one of his friends has an embarrassment, he feels great. Because by his friends being so dumb, it elevates him. When his friends lose a lot of money, it makes him feel great. Why? Now I'm richer. Until now, he was the same league with me. Now I'm the only one. Yeah, I know it sounds funny, but that's the way people think. That's the way people think. This was written over 1,000 years ago. En chadash tachat ha-shemesh. Nothing is new today. These things used to be 1,000 and 2,000 years ago. Some people are religious and they use the religion to reach everything they desire. Meaning, I'll give you an example. If a person from a very young age has a very sharp head, everyone in his yeshiva say to his father, your son is going to be Gdol Ador. Your son is going to be the new Rav Ovadia. He's so brilliant. I enjoy so much to learn with him. He's only 14, but he learns like 24. He's going to be somebody big. This boy, He's thinking, I have a gift. I'm a genius. I must become Gdol Ador. I'm going to be powerful. I'm going to know a lot of Torah. I'm going to be a famous rabbi. I'm going to make millions. Thousands of people will stand online to get a blessing from me. I'm going to be the king of the world. Look at Rav Ovadia, how people push just to touch his hand. Look, you know how all these politicians come that stand online. That's what he thinks. So the entire day and night that he learned Torah, what do you do? Go to sleep. No, no. I'm matmid. I have a lot to learn. The entire reason that he's such a matmid in a Torah is all for his own ego and reputation. Nothing to do for the sake of Hashem. That's not good. I met some people like this in my life. That's what they did. Just to know. The more Torah I will know, the more I can put everyone down. Every argument, I know right away. Here, you're wrong. Here, you're wrong. Just to win the argument. I one time had a chevruta, stubborn like this. You bring him 500 proofs, he does not break. Never give up. So I realized after a while, it doesn't matter. Just tell him you're right, because if not, you will never learn a page in your life. Every little thing is an argument. Why? Because it was never about the truth. It was always about who will win the argument. There are a lot of people like this. They don't really care about the truth. They only want to win the argument. Sometimes it's between husband and wife. That's a disaster. She is full of ego, and he's full of ego. She is full of anger, and he's full of anger. Put them together, it's a nuclear bomb. You don't need Iran. All day. Who is going to say the last word? Sometimes they come to the rabbi for Shalom Bayit. You don't know if to laugh or to cry from the nonsense they talk about. He's telling me this, she's telling me this, she didn't respect my father came, she did not prepare a special. Like kindergarten. Are you sure you're religious? Yeah. One Bukharian guy came to me, he said, Rabbi, I need you to help me to get divorced. Well, you only married for a year or two. What's the problem? What's wrong with her? Listen, I come home sometimes from work. She does not prepare for me a hot meal. So I say, I look at her and say, well, what's the problem? She said, look, I work until 5. By the time I get out, not always I have the strength to go to the supermarket and buy and come and cut and clean and make him a dinner. So sometimes, you know, he should eat some other things. So I say to her, no, by my house, one time, my father never had a day that without hot meal. Because your mother is living with 5 servants. She never works. She doesn't come back at 5 from work. It's a little bit different life. I said to him, but Ray, wait a minute. Is this really the reason why you want to get divorced? As I come home sometimes after a lecture, 1, 2 a.m., I take a little pretzel with a box of hummus from Costco. I eat like this, little baby carrots. I get full and I go to sleep. What? And my wife says, should I prepare you dinner when you come? You eat it. I said, no, I'm going to manage. Sandwich, cheese, what? Cheese. Get full a little bit and go to sleep. Well, what is the big deal? No, by us. That's Muslim mentality, I told him. The woman is not a servant. She has a purpose in life. She didn't come here to serve the world. She has her missions, yes, but this is all about ego. Because he is offended, not really from the meal, because even if she would order a nice fancy meal, hot meal from a restaurant, I would still be upset. Why? Because she doesn't respect him. All these problems in Shalom Bayit are usually come from ego. It's all ego. If you're down to earth, you won't make a beep. One rabbi, his wife used to make for him every morning tea before he goes to yeshiva. After 6 months, he left a little bit tea in a cup. She said, let me finish it. She drank it. She'd been putting salt for 6 months. She filled up the bucket with salt. Every day she puts 2 spoons of salt in his tea, and not once he told her, you're putting salt in my tea. She just found out after 6 months. Why? Not to hurt her feelings. There's hundreds of examples like this. Why? when a person understands what it means to be down to earth and he works on it, he can achieve it. I give you another example. Every enemy a person has, you win him one time, two times, three times, that he would leave you alone eventually. If you defeated him once, twice, three times, every time, he took you to court, he lost. He took you to court, he lost. He took you to court, he lost. He fight for the same customer, you got it. Again, you got it. Again, after a few times, he gives up. This guy's too much for me, I can't win him. But the Yetzer Hara will never surrender to you. 500 times he won, and the 501 he will get you. And we've seen people like this. They've been great for many, many years, boom! In 1 minute, they lost everything. Al ta'amin be'atzmecha ad yom motcha, Chazal said. Don't believe in yourself until the last breath of your life. And we have an example of Yochanan Kohen Gadol, was Kohen Gadol 80 years, he goes into Kodesh HaKodashim. Has to have a pure mind, not to think about one little thing besides the Avodah in Bet HaMikdash. Nobody did it in history. Many Kohanim got in and died. When you think about something else, you fall and you die. They used to pull the Kohanim with a rope. They tied to their legs because no one is allowed to enter. So how are they going to take the body out? They pulled the rope. And he went 80 years in a row. Meaning nobody had a holier head than him. And in the end, he became a Democrat. Meaning he left the religion. After 8 years, he left the religion. You understand why? To show you can never trust anyone, definitely not yourself, until the last minute. Before we finish, you should know, when a person makes Hashem happy from him, Hashem will make all his enemies surrender to him. Birzot Hashem darkei ish, gam oivav yashlim ito. Hashem will force every one of your enemy to bow down to you. Just a matter of time. You do it, and it will happen. And you will have a lot of lovers, and you won't have a lot of enemies. The Yetzer Hara, after trying to get you in every possible way, and he see he cannot make you make sins, the Yetzer Hara is trying to tell you, be mechalel Shabbat. I'm a religious guy. What do you mean, mechalel Shabbat? Don't go to learn today. I'm never going to give up on the Torah. Don't give tzedakah. You give too much. There's no such thing. I will give. Whatever the Yetzer Hara tells you, you don't surrender to him. Are you in a high level or in a low level? High level, right? How the Yetzer Hara will make you lose everything? After you do a great thing, it will come to you and say, you're the best. No one is like you. Believe me, even the Rosh Yeshiva is not tzaddik like you. I'll give you an example. The Saba Mikelem had a yeshiva. He had many, many boys. One guy decided to start Shabbat 1 hour before the time. Let's say Shabbat starts 7 p.m. At 6 p.m. he accepts Shabbat already. The Saba called him to his room and he said to him, wow, I'm so impressed. You're actually starting Shabbat an hour earlier? Very nice. A Yirei Shamayim should accept Shabbat early, not late. But isn't it bad that everyone around here is not like you? Look how many losers we have here. They wait to the last second. With a cigarette. We have another 30 seconds. The Rosh Yeshiva is mixing him up. Guys like this, all they learn Gemara and they don't accept Shabbat an hour like you. So the guy said to me, yeah, Rabbi, I can't believe these guys. It's such a shame. People learn Gemara and they don't want to accept Shabbat early. The Rabbi told him, I command you, from this coming Shabbat, you accept Shabbat 1 minute before the time. What? You're not allowed to start an hour early. He said, why? You just told me it's great, I'm better than everyone. I was testing you. If you doing extra, make you look down at other Jews, you lose more than you gain. Stop. You are proud, full of yourself. You lose more than you gain. You lose more than you gain. Many times, a person does something, but he has a lot of ego. I'll give you an example. They ask a woman, she cooks for the yeshiva every once in a while. Moshe is getting married. This date, they would like to have Sheva Brachos in your house. Would you agree to do it? Of course. Wow, how many people? You have room for how many? Even 100. It's all on us, don't worry. Just invite your people and tell me how many. So far, very impressive. Right the way she agreed, she did not make a limit. What about catering? Should we order from a restaurant? No, God forbid, don't insult me. I'll make you everything you want. Oshpolo and gujguje and everything and sushi, whatever you like. Just tell me what you order. So far, she's Sarah Imenu, out of this world, this woman. The question is, why is she doing it? If she does it to make Hashem happy and to help the poor Chatan, that he will show the other side that there are people who respect him and look what the Sheva Brachot they did for him, that he won't be embarrassed, or something like this, then she gets a huge reward for it. But if she does it because she just moved to a nice house and she put a lot of art on the walls and she wants everyone to come and see and give her a compliment, or she's the best cook and she wants to show to the world what a great hospitality she can put, and she walks around and everybody gives her a compliment, wow, your rice is out of this world, can you give me the recipe? How did you do this meat? It's so good, wow, I never ate such food. She walks around, oh, I did it. She gets zero reward, nothing, and in the end she gets punishment for that, for this entire show. She spent $2,000 out of her pocket, she worked like a dog for 3 days to prepare all the food, she had to clean the next day with her cleaning lady the house, and she gets zero reward. Why? It's mitzvah. Abba abe'avera ena mitzvah. That's what the Torah says. Mitzvah that is mixed with avera at the same time is not a mitzvah. The whole purpose of this was the show off. Nothing else, just the show off. That's why we have to learn how much Hashem hates it. I know it's difficult. It's not easy to be humble. But if you work on it, you take 50% of your pride down, it's already great. You look at things different, you don't care so much about your car anymore. You don't care about a lot of things that right now, if you're not going to have it, you're willing to kill for it. Slowly, slowly, you will change your entire behavior. Next thing, when you actually do something, don't expect a reward from that person. When they, being proud in wisdom, ki'im bazot italel, המתעלל השכל וידוע אותי. You wanna be proud of something? Learn a lot of Torah and get to know me. The more you know me, the more satisfied you have to feel. Why? משמיים הביט השם לראות היש משכיל דורש של השם. Hashem is checking from heaven every day who is a smart person. Who? Smart person is someone that always searching for God in every minute of his life. In traffic, at work, while he's eating, while he's on the way to the flight. Every second, every detail, this, that, sir, put your suitcase here, don't do this, don't do that. I'm changing you to here and you meet someone. Always, Hashem, I see what you're doing. And always busy. Why Hashem did this to me? Why this? What's the message? What's this? What? Every little thing. Everything. With the boy, with the family. You see Hashem every second of your life. You, Baruch Hashem, a very smart person. Pride against the wicked people is superb. Don't ever let a wicked person who makes fun at the religion feel greater than you. Always put him down. There is no time for humility in front of wicked atheists. When they begin to talk against rabbis or against the religion, you be very aggressive with them. Rip them to pieces. That's mitzvah. Don't let them speak. If they say something against the rabbi, attack them brutally, with no mercy. No time for manners. Be quiet before you talk about this person. You nothing. Who are you? Who do you think you are? That's how you talk to them. Not like some people. Why were you quiet? I didn't want to start a fight. They're making fun of the biggest rabbi in the world. They embarrass him in public. They make fun of the mitzvot. They make fun of the religious people. And you sit there and be quiet? That means you don't care about. Not about Hashem. Not about the Torah. Not about the rabbis. If it would be your father, you would sit there and let them make fun of him? You would get angry, right? Ah, because it's your father. But what about your father in heaven? So let me read it to you. הגאווה נגד הרשעים היא משובחת מאוד. Very superb. להוכיחם, to rebuke them. להחלים אותם, to embarrass them. ולא יכנע להם. You never argue to them. Never. You're going to say the last word. If you need to throw them out, get out and leave the house. You contaminate my house. Get out. Why? Because you spoke against the Chacham. I'll tell you a story. About 19 years ago, my brother-in-law's brother, my sister's husband, he has a brother. He came with two friends to a tree. They went to Thailand, and from there, there's three secular guys. They came to America. And that guy, because his brother is my relative, started to listen to my lectures and started to show interest in religion. So his brother said, go to Mizrahi for Shabbat. Take the two guys. Go to Monsi for Shabbat. We made an arrangement. They came to my house for Shabbat. As we sit on Friday night, one of the three guys was very arrogant. Speaks very dirty against rabbis. First he speaks against one rabbi, then against this, then he started against Rav Ovadia. I say to him, how are you not embarrassed to talk against someone? You don't even know what Torah is. You have already complaints, you speak like this. First I was nice about it, hope he's going to get the point, but it was full of ego. He went worse and worse. His two friends told him, you're embarrassing us. We came to a house of a religious family for Shabbat, and this is what you have to talk about? Enough with this. When he saw his two friends also are against him, he got up, pushed the chair like this, and went to the room. Very awkward moment, Friday night in the table. Says, Hashem Yirachem, why do I have to get this test? A minute later, he went to the room. A minute later, he lay down in the bed. We started to hear. Doesn't stop. We got up, all three of us. We ran to the room. We opened the door, me and both of them. I see him on a bed. His eyes came all out like this. And he was holding his neck and going like this. I said, don't touch him. It's going on for like 30 seconds. I don't know what to do. So I touch him, maybe he has bad spirit in him. Who knows what's going to happen? After 30 seconds, he started like this, breathing. So what happened? I don't know, someone came and choked me. I'm much like this. They got the shock of their life. I knew about things like this from the books. But these two chilonim, I never saw in their lives. So the guy told him, you see what happened when you speak about Rav Ovadia? What do you think happened with this guy? 6 months later, I went to Israel. I asked my brother-in-law, how's your brother? How's the two guys? He said, you're not going to believe. Remember this guy who made noise in your house? He went to yeshiva. He gives shiur in halachot ben ishchai. He was an Iraqi guy. Now he's teaching the new guys in yeshiva halachot ben ishchai. Who came to choke him? Maybe it was the ben ishchai, I don't know. But that's what I'm saying. When you have arrogant people like this that speak about rabbis and the religion, you don't be nice to them. Because if you are quiet, they will accept it that you had nothing to answer and you agree. You can never agree. So, lo ichana lahem, do not surrender to them. Will warn from the bed as much as you can. Even though it looks like you are proud when you argue with him, because you are doing it for the sake of heaven, it's superb. Do not ever surrender to the wicked people. And it needs wisdom. Because sometimes, if you be too tough with them, you lose them completely. You have to find a way not to push them completely away, that they become big haters of the religion. But at the same time, you don't let them say whatever they want. So you have to be clever. Pride make crises in the life of a person. A lot of proud people are always depressed. Every once in a while, they have 2 or 3 days, they don't come out of bed, they don't want to work, they don't want to come to the business. Why is it? Every time they don't get what they want to get, it breaks them. Nobody respects me here, or his children do not surrender to his tough behavior. So slowly, slowly, every once in a while, he have a new crisis in his life. Meviya et ha'adam leshever veleshiflut. Why is it? Like I said, the more you have expectation to receive honor, the more when you don't get it, you become broken. The Gemara say, someone who run after honor, the honor will run away from him. Someone who run away from honor, the honor will chase him. Even if you run away from it, you're going to get the honor. One guy came to the rabbi and said, Rabbi, I run every day from the honor, and I don't see the honor is chasing me. The rabbi told him, of course, because when you run away from the honor, every 2 seconds you look, no, where you are? Where are you? That's not running away from honor. Running away from honor means you really don't want people to give you disrespect. If Hashem see that you're really humble and you don't like this show off around you, you will get it anyway. Why? Because it's for the sake of Hashem. Now, one last thing before we finish. Let's talk a little bit about happiness and sadness, which is relates to this. Simcha, happiness, internal happiness. You have to agree with me that most people are not happy in life. Secular people, 1 out of 1,000 maybe is happy. Religious people, you have some people that are happy, but most religious people are also panim tisha be'av, face of tisha be'av. This guy is worried about the shidduchim of his children. This one is worried about money. This one is worried about the business. This one is worried about the government. This one is worried about, if he will get the job or not. Everyone is worried about something. Most people are having sad faces almost all the time. It's amazing how sadness and happiness can affect everything in your life. Let me give an example. Simcha comes to a person only after he reach high level of faith. If he has emunah in Hashem, he can have simcha. If he has no confidence in Hashem, he will always be worried. And when you worry, you can never be happy. Can never be happy when you worry. Never. Nothing will make you happy. If you worry, wow, tomorrow maybe I'm going to lose my house, mortgage, problem, default. You can never be happy when you worry. The only time when you're happy is when you have no stress and no fear. You're not fearing the future. You know you're in the end of Hashem. You have a father that takes care of everything. Automatically, you are able to be happy. Next thing is, someone that is happy will be always healthy. Because when you're not happy, your immune system collapses. When people are sad and under stress, immediately they become sick. What happened? 3 days is in bed. Why? I don't feel good. Why? Because you have low and weak immune system. Happy people, the body overcome diseases. Sad people always have sicknesses. And someone that is happy, when he gets old, he would still look great. Men and women, they won't look bad. People that always worry, they would look bad. That's what Yaakov Avinu said to Paro. Paro saw that Yaakov looks very bad. He asked him, how old are you? He told him, my life was short and miserable. Well, he had horrible life. His son disappeared. His daughter got raped by a horrible guy. His brother came to kill him yet to run. 20 years he was a slave for the biggest crook on earth. They tricked him. They did all this. Then there was hunger. All these things that happened to him. It made him have stress and sadness. Especially when Yosef, that was the thing that killed him the most. That he loved him so much. And so because of that, when he was 130 years old, he already looked like he's 180. He looked very old. In the old days, 130 was not so old. People lived longer. Not like today, right? So you see, people that have comfortable life without stress and fear, they have a lot of money, things works for them, they don't have reason to always be worried, you see that they look very good even in their 90s. But some people who had stress in their life, no faith, no emunah, age 70, they already look like 100. Sometimes you see two people, he's 70, still playing tennis. He's 70, walking with wheels. Why is it? It's all mental. Remember this. Lev sameach yetiv geha. Min ha-simcha yavo schok la-adam. You know, when people are happy, they speak a lot more. Some people that never speak, give them a reason, really something to be happy. They talk non-stop. When they're happy, they like to talk. When they don't talk, you know they're sad. But a person, even when he's happy, should be careful not to be a clown. There's a border. To be happy, to laugh, to enjoy, yes, but not to be a clown. Not to be called that. What else? When your enemies collapse, be very careful not to be happy from it. He got what he deserved, yes. But you should show Hashem that you said, not happy. You heard what happened to this guy? What happened? Wow, he had a big accident. Hashem gave him what he deserved. Oy vey, Hashem irachem. Let me go pray for him that he will be good. Why? Why? He gave you 20 years hard time. I'll pray that he will do tshuva and feel better. That's the right way. And when your friend fell in avodat Hashem and you are happy, it's a very big sin. If you find out, oh, this guy got caught making a sin. And you don't like him, you feel good. Oh, he got, now everybody knows who he is. Shouldn't. Why? Because Hashem is upset that a Jew did chilul Hashem. How can you be happy with something that Hashem is upset? When you see people against Hashem, secular people, it has to break your heart. When people speak about rabbis and the religion, it has to break your heart and you must rebuke them. You have to tell them what villains they are. And what will be their end if they will not do tshuva? When a real good servant is happy when his master is doing well. When his master is happy, the servant is happy. When the master is sad, the servant is sad. If it's the other way around, it shows that you're not a faithful servant. Therefore, if you're a servant of Hashem, and people speak about Hashem and it doesn't bother you, you're not a good servant. But if you're a real servant, it will break your heart to see all the wicked people. Now, there is another bad happiness. Someone that is making fun at strictly religious people. This guy is crazy. He's fanatic. What is this? This he doesn't eat. He never eat deer. He doesn't do this. It's crazy. He makes fun at him. Oh, hine Moshe Rabbeinu came. That's a very, very big sin. Why? It makes Hashem furious. And for sure, Chas v'Shalom, a person bring on himself a lot of problems. He can never make fun at people that are strictly kosher or strictly righteous. If they see a woman, she's extremely modest. And all her friends are not so modest. They have enough. So they like to gather together. Here is grandma. She's fanatic. She's old-fashioned. She's too much. Who does she think she is? She has to put this on her head. Why can't she be normal? That's very, very big crimes to talk like this. They should say, very nice. Kol hakavod. We're very happy for you. I wish we would be like you. Bezrat Hashem, pray for us that we also be righteous like you. That's the right way. You should not flip everything around. When you see someone is going high, you should be very happy for them. If your friend gets married and you still did not find a shidduch, you have to be very happy. Oh, Baruch Hashem, there is one less miserable Jew in the world that was very suffering very much until now, and finally is happy. But what about me? That's nothing to do with me and him. He is what Hashem wants, and me, what Hashem wants. I'm very happy for him. I had a friend, I'm not in touch with him anymore, but back in time, when he was 40 years old, I asked him, let's go and say Mazal Tov. This person is getting married. Let's dance 10 minutes and we go. At least we make him happy that we came. He said, no, I don't go to wedding. I said to him, why? He said, I can't take the pain. So I told him why. So I'm 40 years old, did not get married. This guy, 24, 22, they get married. I can't be there. It kills me. I say to him, you fool. It should be the other way around. You should come and make them happy and say to Hashem, thank you that one person came out of the misery that I have. I'm happy for him. If you will be happy for him, then you have a much bigger chance to get married. Yeah, I know your speeches, I know, but I can't. I'm not going to pretend that I'm happy. Until today, 25 years later, he's still single. Never got married. Why? Sometimes you bring it on yourself, Hashem Yirachem. So, Rabotai, you should know, someone that likes to make fun at people, Hashem Chas V'Shalom will bring him to Sheol Tachtit, the deepest place in hell. Why? It's also considered Machti Arabim, when he makes fun at someone in public, make fun. You have to be very careful. Also, a person should be very careful never to get drunk and start dancing and making jokes and saying all these things. You have control how much you drink. Some people, they drink a little bit, they're already on the table, dancing, taking off their shirt. Somebody like this cannot touch alcohol. Someone who can drink and stay cool, never do stupid things, not embarrass his wife in public. Some wives, every wedding or every family event, even your side, is a nightmare for her. Why are you so nervous? Soon I know what he's going to do. I already know, I've been in this few times. This, on the table, that, making people's yarmulke fly. I once witnessed a clown. There was a clown, Persian clown. He likes to find something ugly and makes fun of him. He gets drunk in a wedding. He walks around 500 people. He finds somebody that looks a little bit strange. And the whole night he makes fun. One time, there was another guy, but much younger, Israeli, that is also like this. Min matzait mino. Ba orev etzel azarzir. They always sit together in wedding, drinking and going to make fun at people. One time, the young guy went searching. And this guy was still sitting in the table. And the young guy showed up and said to him, you're not gonna believe what I found, the ugliest person on earth. If you see him, you will be on the floor from laughing. Where? They ran together. Here. He showed him a guy. The guy looked at him, say, you idiot, that's my father. Now, if these two had a little bit Torah, they knew that everything in life has a purpose. By that second, he would understand that Hashem did it to him for him to feel the pain, how horrible it is when people make fun at you like this. That should have been enough for him to accept that moment. I will never ever make fun at anyone because of the way he looks. Because Hashem designed him, how can I make fun at him? But do you think he stopped to make fun? No. Went right back with his bad habit until what happened to him? He lost his business and became deeply depressed for 10 years. All he does is at home, smoking from morning to night, depressed, taking pill against depression. That's the end. Doesn't go anywhere. Not to family parties, not to weddings. That's it. 10 years, he doesn't come out of his home. Why? Depression. Everything in life, mida keneged mida. Measure for measure. When a person is sad, Hashem's presence leaves him. If he was very attached to Hashem, when he becomes sad, that shows that he has no confidence in Hashem. How can you be sad when the Father, the creator of the universe, is your Father and is watching over you? That means you don't trust me. Right away, the Shekhinah leaves him. If he's a prophet, he loses prophecy. If you said, the presence of Hashem run away from you, the Shekhinah. When you said, you cannot focus on your learning. You go to yeshiva, your head is not in a Gemara. You understand 10% more than what you normally understand. You're not in the mood to do any chesed. You're not in the mood to help anyone. You're not in the mood to act as a husband. You're not in the mood to act as a kosher wife. You're not in the mood to be a good parent. You're not in the mood to be a good son or a daughter. It makes your entire purpose goes down the drain. How bad is to be sad? That's why a person should do everything he can never ever to be sad. The Torah say to the Jews something scary. Hashem is very upset with us, not because we didn't keep mitzvot. 3,300 years ago, everybody kept mitzvot. Look what the Torah say. The Torah say, "Tachat asher lo avadeta et Hashem Elokecha besimcha uvetuv levav." Mirov kol. You know why I'm upset at you? Because you did not serve your God with happiness and happy heart. You had everything and you have the nerve to be sad? Instead of running in the street and dancing. Why are you dancing, Moshe? I'm a son of God. I'm a Jew. I'm 1% of 1% of the people in the world who are the chosen people. I'm from the royal family. I will have the best heaven if I only follow a few instructions of my Father in heaven. How can I ever be sad? The Torah does not complain why you were not religious. Everyone was religious in the time of the Torah. Hashem said to the Jews, I'm very upset with you and I'm going to give you a serious punishment. Not because you didn't keep mitzvot. You kept everything. I'm a witness. But you kept everything with sadness, without a happy face. Your children saw, oh, tomorrow we have to wake up at 6 again. What? Rosh Chodesh. We have to go early. So why are you so sad? You should be happy. We're getting up for Hashem. But that's the way we are sometimes. When a person is happy, everything that happens to him, he said, thank you, Hashem, I know I deserve it. It's not walking around angry, bitter face. Why? Because it's written in the Torah, ve'yadata im levavcha, ka'asher yayaser ish et bno, Hashem elokecha miyasreka. That all the problems you have in life, Hashem did this to you. Nobody else. Just Hashem. Not the goy, not the police, not Sleepy Joe, nothing. It's all because of you. Oh, so wait a minute. I'll give you an example. You walk in the street, you're not in such a great mood. Somebody come behind you, hit you on the back. Boom! Moshe! Oh, I... You're fuming now. You already have your fist ready. You're about to turn around and break his teeth. You turn around, Who you see? The rabbi that saved your soul and you owe him your life. You're so happy, you love him so much, you're willing to die for him. He was the one who was so happy to see you after 10 years. Since you already graduated his yeshiva, 10 years he didn't see you. Boom, he hit you on the back. You were ready to kill him. You turn around and you see him, rabbi! You hug him, kiss him, kiss his hand. Whoa, I'm so happy. Wow, I'm so lucky to meet you. What changed? Before you turn around, you got it. You're ready to kill somebody. Why? Because you didn't understand that you got that punch from the one you love the most. But as soon as you recognize that that was the best love punch you ever got, it made you very happy. And you didn't care about the pain. That's what life is all about. Every one of our problems in life, we forget who gave it to us. And why? When a father takes away his son's bicycle because he goes to places he's not supposed to, when bad kids are, the father wants to torture him or he wants to save him? He wants to save him. The boy is not smart enough to understand. If you have full confidence in Hashem, as it's written, Ashlecha l'Hashem ya'avcha v'hu yechalkelecha, throw everything on Hashem and He will perform for you, then why would you ever be sad? Why? Well, we didn't do this and we didn't do that yet and we didn't finish and we have problems. It's all from Hashem. You work on who you are, fix what you can. Someone that believes in Hashem with full heart will never be scared of the future. Will never bow down to people. Will never kiss up to people hoping they will save him. Will never develop expectation in any human being. Will not agree with wicked people to make them happy. Will not be a politician. Will not be a liar. Will not be a thief. Will always be attached to Hashem. If you have confidence in Hashem. If you don't, you have all the bad things that I mentioned, the opposite. Then, the last thing, the third, is all the things you have, you should always remember it's from Hashem. Nobody can move an inch from you what Hashem wants to give you or wants to take away from you. You should know Hashem always knows what you think, what you think, what you plan, what you really did with a good heart, with bad heart, for the sake of heaven. You can never fool Hashem, you should remember this. Make sure that your will be like the will of God, not the other way around. Don't try to force Hashem to dance according to your music. You dance according to His music. Meaning, if you thought that this is the right thing to do, and your rabbi told you, don't do that. This is wrong. It's against the Torah. You should do this. And you really wanted to do that. But the rabbi told you, no, it's against the Torah. This is what you should do. You should be happy to fulfill the will of Hashem. Cancel your own will. Why? What do you know from your life? What do you know? You don't even know your purpose. You don't even know what's going to be with you. You don't know anything. It's all Hashem. Hashem has a lot of messengers. If He wants you to get something good, He will find a way to make you happy. Rabotai, we should know. We should know that happiness, sadness, and confidence in Hashem, it's all one thing. The more confidence you are, you'll never be depressed. You'll never be broken. Even now when it looks like the end of the world is coming, the dollar collapsed to 3.13. A few months ago it was 4. That means 25% of our money got wiped out in 6 months. If the way it will continue another 2-3 months, that means we won't even be able to do aliyah to Israel. Because if we're going to bring $10 million cash to Israel, we won't be able to buy one house even. Nothing. Because it's going to be dollar and shekel the same. And right now, people who bought houses in Israel for $1 million a year or two ago, now it's already cost $1.5 million. The houses did not go up. In shekel, you have to spend an extra 50% now to buy the same house. Another 2-3 months, it will be already 2 million. Another year, it can be already 3 million. That means everything we killed ourselves to save, when we will have to run away from here, from the anger of the goyim and what's going to happen here in America soon, whatever we're going to take with us to Israel will be worthless. Just like it happened in Venezuela, just like it happened to the Iranian Jews. If they want to leave now Iran, they can't. Because even if they sell their mansion in Tehran, which is nicer than some mansions in Beverly Hills, they won't be able to buy a bathroom here in Queens with the money of their mansion. Why? Because their money has no value. The money of Iran is toilet paper. Same thing Venezuela. So therefore, Hashem is going to show us, you loved America and the fancy life, and now you think one day I'm going to make Aliyah and buy a beautiful home by the beach or in Yerushalayim. Keep dreaming. Soon the houses in Israel are keep going higher and higher. The houses here will be millions of foreclosure in few months coming out because nobody pays mortgage now, nobody pay rent. It's going to be riots on the street. You won't be able to come out of the house when all these people go with guns, give me money or I'll kill you, because they don't already get money for 6 months. They're not making money. The government stopped giving them money. As soon as the government will allow the banks to start the foreclosure, you're going to have millions of people walking in the street hungry for food. And we won't be able to drive our BMW and Lexus anymore because you're going to get a gun to your head. That's what happened in South Africa and some other places. Why? Rich will have miserable life because they won't be able to come out. They won't be able to wear jewelry or a nice watch or a nice car or even to dress nice. No one will put ties anymore. People would live like in Mexico. Some of the wealthy Jews in Mexico, their children go to yeshiva with armed bodyguards. All day they stand by yeshiva that they won't kidnap your child. Why? Because they already know. The cleaning lady told her husband that I'm cleaning this beautiful home and her husband doesn't have what to eat. He's going crazy. Him and his brother, they're going to come to do a robbery. Or they kidnap a kid and they're going to ask for $2-3 million. Because that's what's happened. When the economy collapsed, that's what happened. The question is, we will want to run away from here. Imagine 3-4 million Jews would like to sell their houses here in New York, Beverly Hills, Los Angeles, Miami. Where are we going to run? And on top of everything, you can't even make Aliyah to Israel. They don't let. The crook Israeli government do not let almost anybody make Aliyah. Last year, 2020, 3,150 people made Aliyah to Israel from United States and Canada combined. And only 1/3 of them were Jewish. That's it. About 1,100 Jews made Aliyah to Israel the entire year. That's the statistic. You know why? The Jewish agency, which is very wicked and hate religious Jews, they on purpose do not approve anybody. A Bukharian family, religious, righteous, they want to make Aliyah, 6-7 people. Bring me the birth certificate of your grandmother from Uzbekistan from 90 years ago, when it used to be USSR. Where are you going to find it now? And they want the original. Copy is not good. Bring me the birth certificate and the marriage certificate of your aunt. And the original, which aunt will give her marriage certificate or birth certificate original to be mailed to Israel, and in case it gets lost, she has no proof that she's even Jewish. They do it on purpose that nobody will be able to make Aliyah. Now one convert from Texas sent me an email a few days ago, thank you for warning me that they are hating converts and religious people. When they came, when they interview me on Zoom, they ask me, are you affiliated with any shul? I said no. Do you have a rabbi? I say no. What's your opinion about Orthodox, Reform and Conservative? I have no opinion, she said. So tell us please, how did you convert if you have no connection to the religion?
Wow.
They failed there in the end. Can't win against them. This is the situation, Rabotai. There are people over here, their husband is Israeli, his wife is not, their children are Americans. He cannot bring his own family now to Israel already for a year. He can't go to Israel. Anyone without Israeli passport cannot enter Israel already for a year. But it gets worse. You want to make Aliyah, they don't let you. You want to make a passport, it's closed already for a long time. They are not interested to bring another 2 million religious Jews into Israel. They do everything they can to destroy the religion. That's why they brought 1 million Russian goyim from Russia to Israel 25 years ago, to make more secular people that they will vote against the religion. They don't want religious people take over the government. So they will do everything they can to depress the religion and the religious people to make sure they have control over Israel and keep it wicked and secular. That's the situation. So even if we want to run away from here, it's no guarantee you'll be able to enter Israel. No guarantee. So we don't anymore know what's going to happen. We don't know. It's beginning to look like the Holocaust days. Much like this. What's going to happen, we don't know. People hide cash, people hide gold, people bought bitcoins. How is it going to help you? Let's say you have stuff of gold. Who's going to pay you for what it's worth? Let's say the gold in the market worth $50,000 a piece. You're going to need money. You come to a goy. I need cash. Hurry up. Give me money. What do you think? He's going to give you $50,000? If you're lucky, he'll give you $5,000 for this gold. But it costs you $50. If you have a fancy watch, Swiss watch, you bought it for $40,000. You're going to come to some goy that says, I need cash. What? Give me some money. You're going to give $2,000. But I pay 40. I don't care. You want it? Take it. When we would like to sell our homes, when the goyim will see that in 4 years there is 1,000 homes for sale in 1 month, what's going to happen to the prices? It's going to be $50,000 a home. Costs you $2 million to build, another $1 million for the lot, $3 million you put in a house, forget about all the decoration and all the extra. You're going to come, there will be thousands of homes in the market. Nobody would like to buy it. What happened now with the dollar? The Israeli government bought billions of dollars to raise the price, and it's only going down. Nobody can bring the value of the dollar up. That's it. It's the American currency collapsing. That means our money will only worth in America, nowhere else. You would like to buy an airfare, a flight would be $2,000 around Pesach. $2,000, the price, you can buy it from here. But if you want to buy something overseas, let's say you want to go to Europe and you want to get an hotel, they're going to tell you 200 euro. 200 euro will be like $2,000. Wow. What are you going to do? Even a tiny apartment somewhere in Israel already now is $500,000 or more. By the way, the dollar keeps losing its value. If you would like to buy an apartment, it will be like a price of a house in Great Neck. That's what's going on. And the taxes of the houses keep going higher and higher, and the income goes lower and lower. And who knows what's going to happen. But the good news is that is all Hashem is doing it to us. Why? To take us away from our addiction to material. We became very much comfortable. Too much after material, vacations, Dubai, peace with Dubai. Half of the Jews are already on the way to Dubai. What's going on with you? Hey, you Bachur Yeshiva, what do you have to do in Dubai with all the Arabs over there? You want to see nice buildings? This is your level in religion? You would leave the Yeshiva and you leave your shul and you're going to go to a place just because they're going to have a nice hotel there? Or, no, Rabbi, you don't know, they have water show over there. These religious people, this is how they... We have to get married in Dubai. It's amazing over there. Oh, we have to go... Rabbi, we're moving to Miami. It's so much nicer than New York. This is how religious people talk. We slowly, slowly became mamash like goyim. Even goyim sometimes, I meet some goyim, Arabs and Christians, they're not as materialistic as us. I'm talking about the religious people. So Hashem say, enough is enough. Religion is not to be a robot shomer mitzvot. Religion means you have to work on your humility. You have to be down to earth. You cannot be addicted to material. You cannot run after fake things all the time. Not only food and jewelry and vacations and fancy things. That's not religion. That's a fake religion. Real religious person doesn't care about this thing. Rav Steinemann in his house never changed the furniture 60 years. You couldn't open the drawers. They didn't have wheels. It was the old day when there used to be a piece of wood. You have to take two people to open the drawer. People begged him to renovate his home for free. The richest people in the world were coming on a weekly basis to him. We'll get you a house. We'll buy you everything you want, Kvod Arav. No, I'm very happy with this lousy home. Home in this world is temporary. I want my house in the next eternal world to be fancy, not here. Rav Chaim Kanievsky had mold on the walls, green mold. One builder from Israel came to Monsi for Shabbat. He told me and my son went to Rav Chaim Kanievsky. We have a construction company. I saw the mold. I told him to the grandson, can I come tomorrow with my people and fix the walls? Let me get rid of the mold, repaint, make it nice for free. The guy said, don't get me into trouble with my grandfather. He does not want any home improvement. Never. For free. Never. Why? That's not the purpose of life. I know I speak a little bit high, but if we know the goal, maybe we'll reach half of it. If we don't even know where to aim, we're going to die one day. And Hashem will say, you really think you're religious? Let's check what's the difference between you and an Arab sheikh. Let's see. He likes this, you like this. He likes that, you like that. He likes this, you like that. What's the difference between you and him? He also believes in me, the Arab. What made you better? I don't know. No Torah, no Derech Eretz, no modesty, no nothing, no tikkun amidot. Everything anger, and this, and that, and jealousy. What is this? What is going on? That's why, Rabotai, I came to open up your eyes tonight, my eyes, and the listeners' eyes, watch us all over the world now live. The goal, remember, they asked the Gaon Mivilna, what's the purpose of life? The answer was to fix the midot, the negative personality character, to fix your anger, to get rid of your laziness, to get rid of your jealousy, to get rid of your stinginess, to become a generous person, caring, grateful, never to be ungrateful, always honest, always down to earth, never to put people down, never to be a show off. That's a very hard work. You can be religious like a robot all your life. You die stingy. You born stingy, you die stingy. You born angry, you died angry. You born jealous, you die jealous. You born not modest, you still not modest. You born a liar, you are still a liar. Now one thing improved by you after being religious for 8 years. Nothing. Same chiloni. How do I know? I see people that I made religious here in Bet Gavriel 22 years ago. I showed them the truth. They became Shomer Mitzvot. They started to come to learn. After a year or two, they left me. And each one of them found a community. This synagogue, that synagogue. They went to different places. Now when I spoke very much about the vaccine in last month, some people that I made them religious 22 years ago helped them to put their kids in yeshivot, and they have a religious family, big one already, some already second generation. Wow. You have to see how they attack me in public on YouTube or in emails. Same secular people as they used to be 22 years ago. Nothing has changed by them. Nothing. Same rotten people. Yes, they Shomer Shabbat. Yes, they put Yarmulke and Tzitzit. But the same arrogance, same ungratefulness, same lies, same disrespect, same everything. The Torah says, someone teach Torah, someone made you better in your religion, you owe him your life. If it's you or him, you have to sacrifice your life to go before him. Forget about giving money, that's needless to say. Forget about donation, forget about never to insult him, forget about never to make fun of him. I'm not even talking about this. It goes to the highest level of gratitude. People that you save their life, they not only don't do anything as return, they deny it. I went to a lecture. That's how they are. Either they have short memory or they're naturally ungrateful people. We do not want to be like this, Rabotai. David HaMelech learned two halachot from Achitofel, which was a very wicked person. Achitofel, very wicked. But he learned from him two halachot. Two questions David had, and two answers he got from Achitofel. And he called him Alufim, Yudai, my master, and gave him respect and brought him into his bedroom. He said to Achitofel, I trusted you, I brought you into my own bedroom. Who would let someone walk into his bedroom unless he trusts him 1,000,000%? And in the end, you betrayed me with my son Avshalom to make me lose the kingdom and make me run out of my home. But you see from here that until the last minute, he respected him like he's a god or something. Why? He learned two halachot from him. He didn't make him Baal Tshuva. He did not teach him 20 years in yeshiva. He did not help him to put his kids in yeshiva. None of these things. Just taught him two halachot. He already felt he owed him his life. Moshe Rabbeinu did not want to hit the Nile to make it blood. Why? They hid me in the water. How can I hit this water? It's water. They don't have feelings. I cannot turn water that saved my life into blood. Then hit the ground and make it kinim. I can't do it. Why? When I killed the Egyptian, I buried him. It gave me enough time to run away from Egypt to Midian. If the sand will not cover the body of this Egyptian, I would be caught and I would finish, Paro would kill me and that would be the end of me. I cannot do something to the sand that helped me to save my life. To the sand. Forget about your rabbi. To the sand. Why the Torah tell us all these stories? We have to start being grateful. Most important thing, husband to wife. Almost no husbands respect what their wife do for them. They take everything for granted. Laundry, food, errands, deposit, picking up the children, taking care of them, doctors, this, that, all the things. They take it for granted. One time she messes up, he wants to kill her already. That's all ungratefulness. The Gemara says one rabbi, his wife was very wicked, very big witch. She tortured him, insulted him. The student asked him, Rabbi, how can you stand such a witch? He said, it's enough. She raised my children to Torah and she saved me from the sin. She goes to the mikveh, she let me be with her 2-3 times a month. Like this, I'm focused on my Torah and I don't have to look for other women. She saved me from sin. She raised my children for Torah. It's already more than enough. Everything else is a bonus. I owe her so much. She was abusing him. Why the Gemara brings this story? To talk Lashon Hara about the woman? No. To give you the right idea how you have to appreciate things. Same thing women. Women also take things for granted. Money unlimited. Buy her things. Buy her a good car. Bring her a cleaning lady. Never enough. Why? That's the way we are. Ungrateful people. Now, Baruch Hashem, after this lecture, we understand what we have to do. And Bezrat Hashem, we will work on it. So when we leave the world, we won't only be robots that keep Shabbat and eat kosher. We will be people that Hashem is proud that we are His children. Bezrat Hashem. Thank you very much, Emmanuel, for inviting me here tonight, for your beautiful place here. Baruch Hashem, hopefully we'll do more things in the future. Baruch Adonai Leolam. Amen ve'amen. Rabbi Hanania.